steal my joy, for blood has been poured out, the enemy destroyed, death could not hold him down, the cross was not.
How great is your love? has never been, there will never be a God like you, a love so true. There has never been, there will never be a God like you, a love so true.
us, able to keep us from falling to the only God. Be all glory and honor, majesty and power, for all ages now and forevermore.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome back to another Sunday morning worship. I hope everyone is well rested and ready to hear the Word of God today as we sang our praise earlier. Just a few announcements for this month. We do have one birthday for this month. It is Gerardo's birthday on the 22nd, so make sure to wish him a happy birthday. As I always say, again, month after month, during the time we can't meet physically, Lily and Andrea are preparing the birthday cards, so once we are able to meet, we'll have over a month now that we're a year into our quarantine. Maybe we'll make a happy birthday quarantine birthday card. Prayer meeting, BCM, you should have had it this morning with Chanzaim over Zoom. Adults, we will be having it next week. The time we'll set it, me and Chanzaim, so I'll keep my eye out for that. Also, for our servanthood workshop, unfortunately, we haven't been able to have it yet. We are working to get things. I guess there's many things that can pop up, whether it's a time issue or just things that happen in life, right? So Chanzaim will keep us posted on when we will be having that servanthood workshop. That's actually it for the announcements. For our memory verse for this month, it's actually from John chapter 13, verse 14 through 17. And this is what it says. If I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example that you also should do just as I have done to you. Truly, truly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than the master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them. As always, please do your best to just read over the verses every now and then, John chapter 13, verse 14 through 17. And before we get into today's message, I will also share with you the passage that Chanzaim will be going over. Today, it's going to be John chapter 12, verse 31 through 36, the first half of 36. And this is also the reading of God's word. Now is the judgment of this world. Now will the ruler of this world be cast out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself. He said this to show by what kind of death he was going to die. So the crowd answered him, "We have heard from the law that the Christ remains forever. How can you say that the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is this Son of Man?" So Jesus said to them, The light is among you for a little while longer. Walk while you have the light, lest darkness overtake you. The one who walks in the darkness does not know where he is going. While you have the light, believe in the light, that you may become sons of light. Amen. John chapter 12, verse 31 through 36. So again, I hope everyone is doing well. Let's be prayerful during the times where we're still not able to worship together physically. And again, always keep in touch with one another and keep each other in prayer.
Hey, good morning, Bethel Church. Hope you guys had a great week, and I want to welcome all of you guys to another Sunday service. I just want to thank you guys for tuning in and always being faithful and doing your best to, you know, make these online services work. I know that we have other spiritual engagements via Zoom and even in person as well. And so I hope that as we continue to connect, that God will continue to bless us in those areas and that we may also do our best in staying connected to each other. That is very, very important, guys. And so please do message and call each other up. Please remember to pray for each other as well. I think one of the main ways that we can really keep one another accountable is by interceding for each other, you know, through prayer. Again, God moves through prayers, and so that's really, let's not neglect this privilege that we have, this wonderful tool, a very powerful tool that we have. And so please be in prayer for each other. I pray that as you listen to the Word of God today, that God may bless all of you guys. And before we begin, our sister Brenda will pray for us. And so, Brenda.
Hello, everyone. So before we start the sermon, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for gathering us here today. I pray that our hearts and minds are ready, desiring to worship you, to listen to the sermon today. I also pray that we're attentive and awake, and that we are not distracted by things around us, but we can focus solely on you and your word. I also pray that you may use Kevin Jonas Sanim as your mouthpiece, that he is able to deliver your word, and that you may inspire us, bless us at this time. I also pray that you give us wisdom, understanding, so that we may know you and your son even more. And I pray that we can use that in our spiritual walk as well. I pray that as we worship you today, as we go through the sermon today, that it may be a good foundation for us for the rest of this week, and that we may be energized and strengthened at this time as well. And in Jesus' name I pray, amen.
All right, thank you, Brenda, for your prayer, and let us now get into the Word of God. Today we will be reading from John chapter 12, verses 31 through 36a, and the title for this morning's sermon is The Sweet Hour of Jesus. The Sweet Hour of Jesus. Now, so far we have seen a train of events that took place in John chapter 12, meaning that we have seen events that occurred successively, all beginning with the arrival of the Greeks. You know, as the Gentiles came seeking to see Jesus, to have an interview with Jesus, it signaled to Christ that his hour has now come. But because the hour involved the cross, because the hour involved the crucifixion, where Jesus would now bear the sin of the world, Scripture tells us that his soul was troubled. But in the midst of his crisis, what did Jesus do? Did he ask the Father to deliver him from his hour? No. Rather, Jesus prayed, "Father, I am only concerned about your glory. And so in my obedience, Father, glorify your name." To that which the Father replied, "I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again through your death, burial, resurrection, and exaltation." So the chain of events that led to the hour of Jesus was triggered by the arrival of the Gentiles. And now Jesus was about to do some amazing things for the world. Jesus was now about to do some sweet things for the world. Now in today's text, okay, Jesus provides us with three results coming from his death on the cross. There will be three aftermaths of his death and resurrection. Number one, judgment will now be brought to this world. That's number one. Judgment will now be brought to this world. Number two, Satan, the ruler of this world, will now be cast out. Satan will now be cast out. And number three, Jesus will draw all people to himself. So these are the three things that Jesus will now do at this hour. And so I pray, brothers and sisters, that you guys would see Christ for who he is once again and see the sweet hour of Jesus. Let's read verse 31. Now is the judgment of this world. Now will the ruler of this world be cast out. So result one of the cross is that it brought judgment to this world. The world now stands judged at the cross. Not only then, but even today, even now as I speak, the world now stands judged at the cross. Now the irony is that the world thought it judged Christ by crucifying him as a blasphemer. But in fact, the cross brought judgment on them. Again, the world thought that it passed judgment on Jesus by crucifying him as a blasphemer. But in reality, the cross brought judgment on them. You see, the Jewish leaders thought that Jesus was a blasphemer. You know, in the ancient days, when criminals were crucified, the Romans placed a condemnatory inscription of the crimes committed by the criminals on top of the cross. And so, on top of the cross, it inscribed what the criminals did, what they were being punished for. Now, on top of Jesus' cross, the accusation written against him was King of the Jews. And all four Gospels include this detail. Now, John wrote, Pilate also wrote an inscription and put it on the cross. It read, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. Many of the Jews read this inscription, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Aramaic, in Latin, and in Greek. That was the accusation. You see, in the region of Judea, which was under the control of Rome, only had one king, Caesar. And so if someone came along claiming to be king, that would have been considered treason against the Roman Empire. And that is the reason why the Jewish leaders were always trying to trap Jesus, to get him to say, in plain sight, that he was the King of the Jews. You know, whether they believed it or not, whether they really believed that Jesus was the sent one by the Father, all they wanted to do was find grounds to get him arrested before the Roman government. Remember John 10:24? They said, how long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Christ, tell us plainly. Tell us plainly if you are the Christ. Because Christ means the anointed one, the chosen one, the Messiah, signifying that he was sent from the Father as the King and Deliverer. And so that's why they were constantly saying, come on, say it. Say it clearly. We just need something to get you arrested. And that is what they did. Now another trap was when the Pharisees asked Jesus, is it right to pay taxes to Caesar or not? Because if Jesus said yes, then they would have accused him of being in partnership with the Roman Empire. If Jesus said no, then they would have accused him of being a traitor to the Roman Empire. But Jesus gave them a very wise answer. He said, give back to Caesar what is Caesar's, and give back to God what is God's. And they could not charge him of anything. Again, the irony is that the world thought that it judged Christ by crucifying him on the cross as a blasphemer. But in reality, the cross brought judgment on them, and the cross brought judgment to the world. the world stands judged at the cross. And like I said earlier, even today, the world is a dark place because of sin. But the good news, brothers and sisters, is that the light of the world has come into this world to give life to those who believe. You know, the only way a person can escape judgment is through the cross of Jesus Christ. You know, Paul tells us in Romans 10:9, that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Jesus tells us in John 5:24, truly, truly, I say to you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life. He does not come into judgment, but has passed from death to life. Brothers and sisters, there will be a final judgment at the second coming of Christ, where Jesus will sit on his glorious throne and separate the sheep from the goats within all the nations of the world. But today's passage also shows us that judgment began at the hour of Jesus. The world stands condemned at the cross, but the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ has brought light into this condemned world. And it is only through Jesus Christ that one can be saved and be transferred from the domain of darkness into the kingdom of God. And what I want to tell you guys is that repentance is now. Jesus is the only way. Jesus is the only truth. And Jesus is the only one who can dispense life to those who believe. You see, Jesus separates the condemned and the saved. And for those still in the darkness, you still have the opportunity to believe in Christ while you're still alive, to believe and to be saved and to come to the light. If you depart from this world rejecting Christ, there will be no second chances. There will be no turning back. And so therefore, repentance is now. Repentance is now. Now, some have asked me, why is Christianity so exclusive? Why is Christianity so narrow-minded? Like, seriously, are you guys for reals? That Christianity or Jesus Christ is the only way to be saved? Well, let me just say this. That is the wrong question to be asking. The question is, why did God even make a way to rebellious people? Why did Jesus go through all the suffering and the cross to be the once for all mediator between a holy God and mankind? Why? To save those who would believe. John 3:17. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Amen. So be grateful that there is the light in this condemned and dark world, and that there is an escape from judgment, that which is only through and by Jesus Christ, through faith alone, through Christ alone, through grace alone. He is the light. And so believe in him. Now the cross not only brought judgment to this world, but it also cast out the ruler of this world. Which brings us to result number 2 of the cross. Satan is now cast out of this world. At the cross, Satan became a defeated foe. He has been disarmed. And the question is, what has Satan been disarmed of? And let me tell you guys, at the cross, Satan lost his greatest power or his greatest weapon, death. You see, the word cast in the Greek is ekbalo, which means to strip away power and influence in the world. Before the cross, Satan held the power of death, and he has been using it to enslave the people in this world ever since. Hebrews 2, verses 14 through 15. Since therefore the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise partook of the same things, that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is, the devil, and deliver all those who through fear of death were subject to lifelong slavery. Death has always been a problem for mankind ever since the fall. Because sin caused eternal separation from God and allowed death to have dominion over this world, to have, you know, dominion over the people of this world. And because of that, Satan has ever since been using death as his greatest weapon. Now, according to Psychology Today, it says that people fear death because they believe that it is the ultimate end of everything. Now, this is just generally speaking. It says a lot more in the article, but generally speaking, it says that people ultimately fear death because they believe that it is the ultimate end of all things. It also says that the way we think about death can affect how we think and act in daily life. So I want you guys to think about this. If death is the ultimate end, what do you think people will invest in? What do you think people will invest in this life? To fulfill their time on this side of the world as much as they can before they die. To invest their time as much as they can on all the things of this world before they die. The pattern is people invest in their weeks, you know, working hard so that they can enjoy the weekend's rest with money. People save up. Why? So that they can buy their dream cars, their dream houses, and many other things, just so that they can experience those things before they die. You all heard of YOLO, right? Y-O-L-O. This is the definition. You only live once. And in parentheses, it says, used especially to rationalize impulsive or reckless behavior. Yo, do whatever you want. You only live once, man. Yeah, just go out there. Go all out. Enjoy the things of this world. Because again, you only live once. Come on, man. YOLO. Death has really skewed, has really marred the way we think of this world today. What we think about life, it really skewed the way we think about life. You see, brothers and sisters, the fear of death has caused people to invest and maximize their lives in the temporal things. Things that will only fade away. You know, Solomon said in Ecclesiastes 1:2, vanity of vanities, vanity of vanities, all is vanity. Let me just look at the repetition here. We're talking about the most wise person that has ever lived on the face of this planet. He is emphasizing this law, this universal law, that worldly things and materials are temporary. Nothing in this world will last forever. Did you guys know that? If you didn't, let me just remind you, nothing in this world will last forever. Nothing. Not even your reputation. Not even your popularity. The greatest of human achievements will all be forgotten and left behind at the end. Nothing will matter. Once you die, everything dies with you. The truth is, after you die, you can't look back and say, "Ah, I remember those days. I remember all of those achievements. I remember all the fun we used to have." You will not have any opportunities to reminisce like that, because once you're dead, you're dead. So Satan has been using death as his ultimate weapon to misdirect the world of the true life in God. And that is why people, instead of seeking forgiveness, what do? They seek the temporary things, so that they can fulfill or to maximize their life before dying. You see, that is the misdirection caused by the fear of death. But what the cross did was that it disarmed Satan's power over death. You see, the hour of Jesus dismantled Satan's greatest weapon, death. It's almost as if Jesus took his atomic bomb and made it into a water gun. That's what he did. The darkness of death has now been overshadowed by the light of life, Jesus Christ. Amen. And so believers, I want to remind you guys, Satan no longer has power over you. Satan no longer has dominion over you. The accuser can no longer accuse you in the divine courtroom. Why? Because Jesus took your place on the cross, and your eternal verdict is now not guilty. Not guilty. Because you have been justified by the righteousness of Jesus Christ in His death and resurrection. Therefore, people no longer have to fear death as the ultimate end. Again, people no longer have to fear death as the ultimate end. Because in Christ, the ultimate end is heaven, to be present with God. And the life we now live, we can live for God to His glory. And we no longer have to live for the temporal things. I know sometimes it's very tempting. Even though we know that we are in Christ, don't we sometimes gravitate towards the things of this world because they look so enticing? But the truth is, we no longer have to do that. We are no longer enslaved to the fear of death because we know that we have a better reward in heaven. We know that we are, you know, our eternity and our salvation has already been sealed by the death of Jesus Christ. And so, even though we are tempted, let that only be a temporary thing. I pray that you will find victory and that you won't look to the things of this world, because again, nothing in this world is forever. And so I want you guys to focus on the eternal things, your spiritual growth, to be in the Word of God so that you can glorify God and to enjoy His blessings and to enjoy Him. Only He can give the ultimate satisfaction and joy in life. And so I pray that you guys would work to that end in Christ Jesus. 1 Corinthians 15, let me read verses 54 to 57. Death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, what is the third result of the cross of Christ? Let's read verses 32 through 33. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself. He said this to show by what kind of death he was going to die. So result number three of the cross is that Jesus will now draw all people to himself. Now when Jesus says, when I am lifted up from the earth, he is literally referring to his crucifixion. However, it can also have a double meaning, you know, the phrase being lifted up, because the idea of being lifted on a cross and glorification usually follows together in Scripture. Now let me give you guys one verse out of the many that supports this idea. Hebrews 1:3. He is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of His nature. And He opposed the universe by the word of His power. After making purification for sins, which is the crucifixion here, He sat at the right hand of the majesty on high. And that is the picture of His exaltation. And so again, there is that double meaning from the phrase lifted up. It can refer to both Jesus' crucifixion and or glorification. But here, in our text today, Jesus was literally referring to His crucifixion. And we know this because John said that that Jesus was explaining the kind of death that He was going to die, which was by being crucified. You know, back in the days, the phrase lifted or lifted up was a euphemism for death. Death by crucifixion. Because when people were crucified, they were lifted on a wooden cross. And so Jesus was saying, when I am lifted on a cross, I will draw all people to myself. And here the phrase all people doesn't mean universal salvation, okay? It just means that all people will come to Christ without distinction. And so Jesus was saying, I will draw Jews and Gentiles as I am lifted on a cross. I will die so that all people might find the way, know the truth, and receive the gift of life for both Jews and Gentiles. Brothers and sisters, the cross is a reminder that God loves the whole world, and we are to take the gospel to the whole world and to share it with all people without distinction. I really pray that you guys would share it and proclaim it as if your life depended on it, as if their lives depended on it. We're talking about heaven and hell. If people don't know the gospel, they will not be entering heaven, but rather they will be going to hell. And so you have to share it and proclaim it with all people, not just with people you like, or not just with nice people, but even with those who hurt you, because they also need the gospel as well. Let the world know, for God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. So let me remind you again of the three results from the hour of Jesus. Number one, judgment of the world. Number two, the dismantling of Satan, of his power over death. And number three, the drawing of men and women from the ends of the earth without distinction. Now let's see how the crowd responded to Jesus being lifted up on a cross. Verse 34. So the crowd answered him, "We have heard from the law that the Christ remains forever. How can you say that the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is the Son of Man?" Now the crowd was confused. They didn't quite understand what Jesus was teaching, nor what he was saying. I mean, they knew that the Son of Man was a title for the Messiah, but they just could not fathom the idea of a crucified Messiah. You know, the crowd said, "Hey, didn't the Old Testament teach that the Messiah would live forever?" And I'm very sure they had many passages from their scripture to back that up. But let me just share with you guys two verses from the Old Testament. Psalm 72:17. "May his name endure forever, his fame continue as the sun." Psalm 110:4, "You are a priest forever, after the order of Melchizedek." And so again, the crowd was saying, we have heard from the law that the Christ remains forever. And so since that is the case, how can you say that the Son of Man must be lifted up? For them, it was very contradictory to what they have read and what they were hearing from Christ. Okay, the Messiah remains forever. That's what we've read. But you're telling us that the Messiah is to be lifted up on a cross. We don't see the parallel here. We don't see the connection here. Now, of course, God is never contradictory because Scripture is infallible and without error. Then what was the problem here? Why was the crowd so confused? They were confused because they didn't know Scripture, or they didn't know it enough. You see, there are passages that speak of the Messiah's coming to defeat his enemies and to exalt the nation of Israel. There are passages to support that. But there are also passages that speak of the Messiah being cut off before his glorification. And I'm going to just share one. It comes from Isaiah 53. By the way, it's one of the greatest chapters in the Bible, okay? Isaiah 53. I'm going to read Isaiah 53:8. "By oppression and judgment, he was taken away. And as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living." Now, there are many other passages that prophesy the death of the Messiah, including Daniel chapter 9. But the crowd here did not really look into the passages where it spoke of the Messiah being cut off before his glorification. Now, these people only memorized the verses that they liked about the Messiah, or liked about their Messiah. And that was the main reason why they were so confused about the Son of Man being lifted up. You know, they looked at scripture as a spiritual buffet. They accepted what they liked, and they rejected what they hated. Well, isn't that an issue that we all face today as well? You know, learn and memorize passages that we like, and reject the passages that take away from our lives. And so we say, you know what, I'll take the promise of God where he says that all things work out for the good of those who love him. But I don't want to hold on to Jesus' command and saying, pick up the cross and follow me daily. You know, I'm not feeling that today. Or I don't know if I can really live up to that. And so that is not relevant. You know what, guys? We can't do that. We can't do that. In order to see the glory of God, you need to have a fair and balanced knowledge of the Word. And so don't look at the Bible as a spiritual buffet. Please, don't do that. You know, when you guys approach the Bible, approach it with the heart to submit at every angle and to obey for the glory of God and for your joy. Approach the Bible to submit to the Word at every angle with humility. Well, Jesus doesn't really answer their question or the crowd's question here, because there was something more urgent at hand. You see, judgment has now come, and so Jesus did not want them to miss the opportunity to believe and to be saved as the light was still shining in their midst. And so let's read what Jesus says, verses 35 through 36a. So Jesus said to them, "The light is among you for a little while longer. Walk while you have the light, lest darkness overtake you. The one who walks in the darkness does not know where he is going. While you have the light, believe in the light, that you may become sons of light." Now, when the crowd asked, "Who is this Son of Man?" Jesus did not answer their question. But Jesus did say that he will be with them only a short while longer. He said, "Look, you all have the light for a little while longer. And so walk while you still have the light. Walk into the light while you still have the light. Believe, walk and believe into the light while the light is still here." That is what Jesus was saying. Because Jesus is the light, right? Jesus is the light of life. And he said in John 8:12, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." And so while they still had the opportunity, Jesus was calling them to believe. Now Jesus was telling the crowd to believe while they still had the opportunity. You know, by faith, these people could have passed out of spiritual darkness into the light of salvation. And again, Jesus was saying, walk while you still have the light. Believe while you still have the opportunity and the chance to repent and to place your faith in me. You know, what happens to people in a dark room? They stumble and fall, right? You know, there were many times when I used to hit my shin on lower tables and step on a lot of sharp objects in a dark room, only because I was lazy to reach over to my phone and to turn on my flashlight when going to the restroom in the middle of the night. And so I risked it. I tried to, you know, maneuver my way, you know, through the dark room, and I just ended up hurting myself and bumping into a lot of things. You know, what happens when you have even a small, tiny light in a dark room? What would happen? You would most likely see most things, right? And the reason behind that is because light always overtakes darkness. Let me say that one more time. Light always overpowers and overtakes darkness. That's what light does. Well, those, you know, who reject Jesus Christ will have no idea where they are going in life. Ultimately, they will not. They will not even know what they are living for. They're going to just live their lives chasing after the wind and eventually die. And when they die, they will be transferred into the lake of fire. And let me just be very clear about what I'm talking about here. I'm talking about hell. For those who pass, you know, on this side of eternity or from this world without knowing Jesus Christ, they will be transferred into the lake of fire. I know that is very hard to hear, but it is the final destination for those who reject Jesus Christ. And as explained in the book of Revelation, it is a place reserved for Satan, false prophets, and those whose names are not written in the book of life. And these are the people who lived in darkness rather than light because they loved darkness. You know, they enjoyed life in this world just YOLOing. And you know what? People can enjoy life YOLOing in this world and in this life. But in the end, that's it. You lose everything. And, you know, including your life. I want you to think about that. If you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ, believe so that you can be sons of light and children of light. You know, the hour, the cross, brought judgment into this world as we have seen today. But thanks be to God that Jesus Christ made the way to escape this judgment by believing in Him and Him alone. You know, He dismantled Satan's power over death through His resurrection and now offers salvation to all men and women without distinction. Believe while you still have the light. For you, it means believe while you're still alive and have the chance to repent on this side of eternity in this world. For Christians, let us continue to shine the light of Christ so that we can be instruments for God to bring His people to Himself. And also, since you are sons of light, I pray that you would reflect your Lord and your Savior through all that you do. Again, so that people may see your good deeds and glorify your Father who is in heaven. Let's bring glory unto God. And let's be the salt and light. Let's be the shining light of, you know, what we believe in or who we believe in through our lives in this world. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Father of lights, every good gift and every perfect gift is from you. Thank you for the greatest gift, your Son, who by the cross dismantled the power of death and unforgiven sin through his death and resurrection. As we rejoice in our salvation, teach us to live for your glory and to be the light of this world, so that the world may see our lives and be drawn to Christ for salvation. Help us to trust in your promises, and help us not to live like the world where we focus on the temporal things of life rather than the eternal things. Our purpose is to glorify you and to enjoy you, because only you can offer the abundant life through your Son. Holy Spirit, guide and direct our lives so that we may walk in the path that is lit with the Word of God. Thank you, and we pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.